This is the fluff portion of the session. I am not a PhD, unlike my previous speakers. I'm one of those ABDs that that Phil was referring to.
I still respect you.
Thank you. Well, I think we've got a lot better, actually.
I have that cheap JD degree, actually.
Oh, okay. All right. Oh, good. Well, what am I planning? All right. Well, then this is no longer the fluff portion. In our industry, I think we have ill-served users, and in the way that the web is becoming incredibly personal now, and many industries are targeting individuals, we have historically really left them to their own devices. The products that we produce aren't targeted for them. We have, with a library subscription model, we have a layer in between the publisher and the user, and we have an opportunity to break that wall down and become a little bit more clever. There's a huge amount of discussion right now about information overload, and I think it's true that there is perhaps too much information and filter failure and any number of other things happening. And we all are aware of the fact that multitasking actually doesn't work, and most of us are ingesting information in a very scattered way. In the symptoms here of information overload, I particularly like impaired judgment based upon overconfidence. Well, I searched it on Google. That's it. I've suffered from that many times myself. So at Highwire, we did some research on users over the last year. The research study was conceived by John Sack and carried out by Michael Newman, who's the librarian at Stanford Biology Library. Caveats are that these were all Stanford researchers that we interviewed, so you have to take that with the grain of salt required. But we went across many different disciplines, and I'm just going to briefly summarize some of the things that we learned. I mean, many of the issues came up that you would expect about lack of time, trust, which sources they typically use and which they don't for their research. There were some consistent findings across the board. First was, their workflows are not about the published record, and we need to respect that workflow and fit in with their workflow as opposed to requiring them to fit into ours. A couple of years ago, Alan Rainier, who's a researcher who likes to lecture publishers on all of their failures, spoke at an STM Innovations meeting, and he said that research was like a video game, and whenever I have to go to a publisher's website, I lose 2 points. And that's how we felt about the products that we are producing in the digital space. So time-saving tools, productivity is more important than novelty. All of the things that Phil and Oliver were talking about in terms of scanning and filtering and signposts, measures of quality, all of those things are very important. And then new media, an interest in being able to ingest complex information in new ways. What was interesting was there wasn't as much trust for social networking as there were for things like audio and video. But we had to do a lot of reading between the lines, because what people say and what they mean are often different things. So when we asked about mobile, everybody said, well, of course we're mobile. We carry our laptops everywhere we go. None of them were using iPads or iPhones even, or smartphones, for their daily research. Obviously, they use them for personal reasons and entertainment. And when we talked about social media, networking, communications, how they approached community, most of them cited email and Skype, not Facebook, not the telephone. And when it came to reading, what they really meant were skimming. So we asked, for example, how many journals do you typically read? And most of them had said somewhere between 4 and 6. Some said 4, some said 6, that I tend to read regularly. And when we delved a little bit deeper, almost all by reading actually meant I look at the ETOC alerts. In our industry, we haven't necessarily addressed some of these in the ways in which we're presenting information. Search tools remain absolutely the primary way that people are getting at information. But I like this quote, Google is like crushing rock. You lose the delight of discovery in grinding through stuff to find a few good articles. I found that heartening. The feeling is that there, with all of this information in digital form and all of the tools in which to access it, there's a lot of efficiency but a loss of serendipity. And this is particularly important, I think, to researchers, maybe above and beyond, say, clinicians and those in other professions, because serendipity is where the ideas are generated, and it's very important to be able to provide that. And I think we could do a lot better job of providing serendipitous discovery. Finding content is easy, reading takes a lot of time. That, I think, is pretty self-aware. So a lot of us, I'm sure, find a lot of things that we set aside to read for later, and then later never comes. And then using new media, being able to make the information fit into people's lives more efficiently. Having summaries, having podcasts, videos, things that people can do when they're not able to read. So some of the takeaways here on this were interesting. First of all, there was a lot of consistency across the disciplines, social science, humanities, the various different STM research areas. We only had a few clinical researchers, but not clinicians. And conservative towards change. People were interested in sort of new tools and devices, but very reluctant to waste a lot of time to use them. And that's where productivity was much more important than novelty. They had to feel it was going to be worth their while. The gee whiz factor that we are all attracted to isn't necessarily always what they're looking for. So I think the question is what can we be doing at Highwire, of course, we think in terms of electronic publishing, what can we be doing that would be more effective to help with these problems instead of contribute to them? John Sack at Highwire likes to say that what we've built are like the Swiss Army knives. The websites that we've built are like Swiss Army knives with all of the blades out, overloaded with features and things that people don't necessarily need, certainly not all at once. And that's the way in which we present published content, typically on websites. And of course, we're guilty as charged, just like everyone else. So what can we do to really shift that? And we've done a few things. We have pop-up abstracts that help save a couple of clicks. Anything you can do to make Alan Lanier less annoyed with us is a good thing. Others are doing things, the BMJ Pico format. It's the summary format of an article. It's the aid to that scanning, that quick view. I know a lot of publishers are providing impact statements, things like that, that give the reader something quick and easy that they can ingest. And we know they're going to do this, so we can't force them to read the entire article, but we can help them actually gain the information that they need, and hopefully we'll keep them coming back for more. Video abstracts, this is the American Chemical Society's video abstracts. So we're doing things. We could be doing more. I mean, these are mock-ups coming up next. You know, borrowing from Amazon, scroll through recommendation widgets, clear up some of the real estate, provide more intelligent choices. Choices that are presented in a visually appealing way and that save time. Be scrolling in place widget with recommendations, with related content, with related multimedia, play in place videos. Things that save the user that additional separate set of clicks, and also provide visibility to content that they wouldn't necessarily associate with the article directly. And this is, I think, critical because there is a huge amount of information, and much of it actually is very valuable, and they would like to see it if they could. But we're not necessarily maybe putting it in front of them in all of the most meaningful ways in their regular workspace. Search, what we found is people don't want a lot of additional information in their search results, but they don't mind having them nearby. So don't muddy my results with a lot of extra information that I didn't think I was looking for, but present it to me in another form, in another way, again, a sort of visually appealing way. The promise of personalized search tools has never really borne fruit. But there are certainly new ways in which readers are interacting with data and information. And we need to begin to think about how what we're doing will fit into these new ways. The touch screen, obviously. Augmented reality, the ways in which people are increasingly interacting with information, will fundamentally change how you present it. And we should be preparing for that. Microsoft Surface has Microsoft built one of the newest forms of touch data interaction. This is actually in existence now, and people are using it for various different functions. It's shifting, it's combining your smartphone with smart surfaces, transfer of data between devices, and interactions of various different, you know, mapping, e-commerce, and multimedia applications. I like this part. I had the pie. But as you think about how people will interact with information in this type of environment, it really is fascinating to consider how we present it. Skinput is a way of direct skin data interaction using the human body as an interface for input. And so one should consider, how will your content look in this? again, Microsoft taking that services idea that they've created and turning it into a 3D environment and combining it with holograms. So you'll see this man is actually literally passing the data from hand to hand. This guy doesn't know what to do with it. These guys must love Star Trek. Okay, are you ready? Thank you very much.